Hi everyone. So today we actually cover introduction to computers and programs in Java. Just before we start the lecture, I want to point you to the labs. So the labs will be in course documents. They are actually set up as assignments. So basically you will join the lab today. Brandon Fogg will show you from scratch how to install Java, JDK, Eclipse IDE on your computers, where to download them from, what to search on online for. Then he will show you also to, usually by default, Java C is not added to the path, at least for Windows. So he will show you how to add the Java C to the path, then how to install and Eclipse, download and install Eclipse. Then he will show you how to create projects and run and debug. Then one thing that I want to add is the fact that Java is a compiled language. So you will learn how to run directly the Java compiler, Java C, in the command line interface, which it's different for different operating systems, CMD or PowerShell for Windows, Terminal for Mac OS X, or terminal bash shell, or any other type of terminal shell on Linux versions. Also, he will give you a little bit of basics of how file system is organized, folders. There is a root folder, like for instance, C colon in Windows, or forward slash, basically the root on Linux. Then he will show you how to change folders, what's the difference between the current directory and directories relative to this current directory and absolute folders. He will also tell you about text files versus binary files. Text files are those that basically contain text encoded in that text file, like for instance, source code.java files are text files. And binary files are binary files, basically files that contain bits, zero and ones, and they are not humanly readable, unless you have some editor that basically can transform those bits, bytes into a different, some language. Then he will introduce you to basic commands on the terminal. LS is the command that you can basically use on macOS or Linux for listing the current directory content. The similar one is called dir on Windows. CD is used for both operating systems for changing folders. If you want to move to the parent folder, double period is basically the parent folder. Even the delimiters are different on different operating systems. So for instance, forward slash is used as a delimiter for the different folders on Linux, backward slash for Windows. You can remember these two delimiters. Basically, forward slash is like a person leaning forward, left to right. And backward slash is like a person leaning backwards, right, basically right to left. On Linux, you can find the current folder by just running pwd. On Windows, when you run cmd, you actually can always see what's your current folder, where you are currently located. And then standard Java and Java C, basically the basic commands to compile and to run Java programs. I included a command line for beginners. It's a tutorial that I got from Ubuntu. And basically this goes over a little bit of the history of shells, of command line shells. And then a little bit of how do you run a shell? How do you run the create folders with mkdir? How do you change folders and so on? These are really optional. Basically, what I want you today is to really play with all of this so you understand how to work on Java programs later this semester. One other thing that I included in the lab for today is actually an online a terminal. So this is actually a terminal that runs in WebAssembly. It basically runs on your own desktop. It's like an operating system on your own Chrome, in my case, browser. And the advantage is that it basically has everything that you need. You don't need to basically have a Windows, Linux virtual machine or anything else to be able to run your experiments. So as you can see here, I'm currently now in a shell for Linux, and ls lists the current files in the current directory. Pwd gives you where you are in home user. You can edit files with Pico. So hello.java. And now I already wrote a file here. It saves your current directory files into the current workspace. Control X is to exit, and Control S is to save. Once you save the file, you can compile it with Java C, and you can run it with Java. In this case, that file only prints high. So it's really a way to standardize the interaction with a shell. The problem is really that you have different shells for different operating systems, and basically it's better to learn it for Linux, kind of considered to be the standard. Now, the lab for today is posted on Blackboard, as I basically told you. But I always post the lab for basically the next lab in Piazza. So I already posted already that here the lab for today was posted in course documents on Blackboard. And Brandon Fogg will actually go over the lab for you. He's the leading TA today, and he will show you everything that I enumerated here. Once you are done with the lab, you should submit Hello World and changemaker.java, which are actually two problems that you will find in the lecture in the lecture notes as your submission for this lab. The deadline for every single lab is the Saturday at midnight. So you have time the whole week to work on it. The earlier you submit it, the earlier you are done with it. But basically you have time to work until the weekend and Saturday on the lab for the week, on every lab for the week, lab one and lab two. Lab two is also posted below lab one, and I will post it on Piazza afterwards. So today we'll actually start with the first chapter of our textbook, Introduction to Computers, Programs, and Java. Before I start with the lecture, do you have any questions about the lab? So please consider the labs as practice. Basically, even if you submit a single file for any lab, that's fine with me. What I want you is to practice as much as programming. Learning a programming language is like learning a foreign language. You need to practice a lot. At the beginning, one of these problems that you have in the lab will take probably around the entire lab, 1 hour, but later they will become easier and easier. So as you practice more, you will be able to finish these lab problems in 10 minutes, in 5 minutes, or as fast as you can, okay? So I will put as many labs as possible, so you can practice as much as you can. But the only thing that I require is that you make a submission for the lab, basically one problem at least, so I can give you the credit for the lab. So we'll start with the first lecture on introduction to computers, programming, and programs and Java. So all of you are familiar with computers. By computers, I don't mean only computers, smartphones, laptops, iPads, all of these are basically the same concept. You have a CPU, central processing unit, that interprets every single instruction, usually in a program that is stored in memory, on the hard drive, and is brought to main memory. You have memory, and this is split into two. You have the main memory, which is transient temporary memory. It lasts as long as basically the computer is powered, and you have persistent memory like a hard drive or a hard disk. Then you have some kind of a monitor, even that is a touch screen or actually a screen or a monitor. And then you have input and output devices. So you will have input devices like keyboard, mouse, even touch screen. And then you have output devices as like the monitor, printers, network cards, and so on. Usually all of these components are connected with a single bus or multiple buses. These are basically a common interface that all of these components interact with. And they listen on this common interface, and usually every single message has a sender and a receiver. So they basically, when they see that the receiver is that specific interface component, they will interact. So usually the CPU is the one that controls the entire execution of your computer, but that's not entirely true, because now we have a graphics card that has a graphics CPU. We may have multiple cores on this CPU, and basically you have multiple kind of cores or CPUs working at the same time. Also, it's not quite true that always you have a single bus or communication mechanism, because many of these outputs are on different kind of connectors. So you have USB as a connector, the network interface as a connector, and so on. And Wi-Fi, LTE, or any kind of cellular network, and so on. So this is really simplified to how a computer really works at the basic level. Now, the CPU is the most important part. It's the central processing unit. It retrieves instructions from memory and executes them in a sequential order, like a program that you saw in the previous class in Java. The CPU speed is measured in hertz, which mean cycles per second. Usually you have megahertz or gigahertz. So 1 billion instructions per second. So basically the CPU will take instructions from the memory, usually from some main place like the main method, and executes them. It's not also true that one pulse is one instruction, because these instructions are actually pipelined. So there is one part of the CPU that actually reads the instruction, while another part of the CPU executes the instruction, while another part of the CPU stores the results in main memory or in the cache. So basically, it may take multiple pulses to execute an instruction, usually seven pulses. But in fact, when you pipeline them, so basically different parts of the processor work on different tasks, they average out to basically one pulse per instruction. The memory, the main memory in this case, stores the data and the program instructions to be executed by the CPU. Now, this memory it's in bits. So everything in the computer are transistors, and they are on or off, zero one or zero. Now, these bits, binary digits, are basically grouped into groups of eight, and that basically makes a byte. A byte is eight bits, and usually for simplicity, we basically consider all of these instructions to be sequences of eight bits. You can consider that the entire memory is split into slices of eight bits. It started with slices of eight bits, and that's basically what we define a byte. For about 20 years or so, this was the classical, every single 8-bit location can be addressed, and it contains an instruction. But afterwards, of course, instructions got bigger. It's also easier to bring more data at once, an entire block of 32 bits or 64 bits. So basically, 4 bytes or 8 bytes into one single block. So in fact, most modern computers today work either on 64 bits or 32 bits or even 16 bits. Okay, but we are still considered that the smallest slice of bits that can be basically addressed in memory are bytes of 8 bits. Now, we may actually go a little bit behind and ask what is binary number system. So we as humans, we have 10 fingers, and we basically invented all our mathematics in base 10. So when we say that there are 55 students in this class, we mean that we have 5 multiplied with 10, which is the position of the first 5 in our number, plus 5 multiplied with 10 to the power 0. So basically, we use this base system of 10. And we basically, from antiquity, when we were counting our belongings, somebody has 10 cows, they will basically show 10 cows, or they have 12 cows, then they will show 1, multiply with 10, plus another 2. So basically, that's the base 10 system. However, computers use a binary number system because they basically, in every location in memory, they can store 1 if that location is on, or 0. So a computer basically works in base 2. And your first question may ask, why do computers use binary and not base 10, decimal? And the answer is that electronics transistors were developed in such a way that they can basically store 0 or 1. And there were actually ideas of creating computers that work in base 10, but binary computers are much more efficient. Space-wise, you don't need to do conversion from binary to decimal and then actually store anything in memory. It's also cheaper to produce basically transistors that are 0 or 1. They don't need to do any kind of internal base conversion. So everything in memory is stored as 0 and 1s, and they are also addressed into groups of 8 bits. So as what I called you before, bytes, which basically means that everything that we are writing is actually translated into binary before it's stored in memory and retrieve from memory. And there are encoding schemes for characters, like for instance, J encode is encoded in binary as 01001010. So it's basically, there are encoding schemes that given every letter in the alphabet, they are encoded as binary. Numbers are directly encoded as binary, so basically, any number in base 10 is converted into base 2 and then stored into memory. And on the way back, because they can't, we usually don't present to users data in binary, these binary numbers are converted into base 10 and then presented to the user. So internally, the entire memory is sliced into slices of 8 bits. There is a question in the chat. Do numbers and letters have different binary sequences? I'm not exactly sure what you mean by that, but I'm sure that I will address it in a couple of seconds. So I will tell you, first of all, how this conversion from decimal to binary is done. So you learn a simple algorithm, which was actually invented by Euclid 300 years before our era, that actually does collects the remainders after division with the base, and those remainders are actually the binary number or in any base that you are want to translate into. So I will show you first how numbers are converted into binary and from binary back to numbers, and then I will show you how letters or characters are converted into binary, and that those binary numbers are converted back into letters. Okay, So you can also consider that instead of remembering your the binary numbers that correspond to letters in the alphabet, those letters map to some decimal, and that decimal is translated into binary. But that's not quite true, because basically there is no reason to do this two-step translation. You can basically translate letters directly into binary by having a mapping of letters to binary. And then you can translate numbers to decimal numbers to binary by applying that translation, that algorithm for coming out with a binary number corresponding to a decimal number. So I think the answer to your question, do letters and numbers have different binary sequence? Maybe it's related to what I just said. Another question that maybe one would ask, and maybe that's what you're referring to, is how are these bits? So are they represented then decimal number left to right or right to left? And actually, that's a question for the architecture, a little bit below, where they do translation from values stored physically in the transistors to what is presented to the operating system. So there is little endian and big endian, which are basically different architectures store the number in different sequence, in different order. So maybe that's what you meant by that question. But if you don't get the answer in a couple of minutes, then ask again, and then I will try to respond more precisely to that. Okay. Okay, so let's first talk about number systems. So what we are used to as humans, we have the decimal number system. It has 10 digits from 0 to 9, and a decimal number is represented as a sequence of these 10 digits. So as an example, I will just open Notepad and 123. That's a decimal number, okay? So a decimal number is represented as a sequence of these digits. The value of each digit in the sequence depends on its position. So 123 is, of course, different than 321, okay? In what respect? The order of the digits are different. So this is 123 and this is 321. This is about almost three times larger than this one. But why? Because the digits are the same. Because the position in the sequence has the value that is an integral power of 10. So the meaning of that is that basically what the meaning of 123 is that it's 100 plus 20 plus 3. But that is the same with 1, the digit that appeared in the first position, multiplied with 10 to the power 2, so 100, plus 2 multiplied with 10 to the power 1, which is 10, I will not rewrite it, plus 3 multiplied with 10 to the power 0. So basically, what we are doing here, we are saying that given a number like 7432, like we have in the lecture notes, in fact, we look at the positions of this number, and we actually start from the last one. The last digit has index 0. Then the next one to it, we start counting from the right-hand side to the left with 0, starting with 0 and then incrementing with 1 for every position. So basically, this 4 has the index or the position 2. And 7 has the index or the position 3. Okay, so now that number 7432 is 7 multiplied with 10 to the power 3, which was the position, the index for 7, plus 4, the digit that we have in that number, multiplied with 10 to the power 2. Plus 3 multiplied with 10 to the power 1, plus 0 multiplied with 10 to the power 0, which is basically 0. 0 multiplied with anything is 0. 3 multiplied with 10 to the power 1 is 30. It's not 0, sorry, it's 2, these digits. So it's 2 multiplied with 10 to the power 0, which was 1, so which is 2, then 30, then 4 multiplied with 10 to the power 2, which is 400, and 7 multiplied with 10 to the power 3, which is 7,000. So that's basically how do we do conversion, how do we think about numbers in decimal. Okay. And that why that happens is because 10 is the base of this number system, of the decimal number system, or also called the radix in some cases. Similarly, for binary, 2 is the base. So basically, when we have a binary number, 2 is the base. 2 will be used as the base to which power we raise, which we raise to the power of the position. And there are only 2 digits in the binary system, which are 0 and 1. Okay. Similarly, the hexadecimal system has 16 digits from 0 to F. Basically, they wanted one character for every digit. So they started with 0 to 9. And then for 10, they use A. For 11, they use B. For 12, they use C. And so on up to 15, they use F. So that's exactly the same idea. When we have binary numbers, basically we have 0 and 1s. They are called bits or binary digits. And it's basically every number is a sequence of 0 and 1s. And this is what is stored internally in the computer. Binary numbers are not intuitive to us at the beginning because we are basically used to the decimal system in our daily life. And basically, when you write any number without specifying what base is it in, you mean it in decimal. Internally, computers take your input from decimal and convert it into binary. And when they present an output to you, they convert that binary into decimal back. This is if we convert numbers. So the binary number system contains the digits 0 and 1. Decimals, as we know, from 0 to 9. Hexadecimal are using from A to F. They wanted to use one single character for every digit. So basically, instead of using 10, which are actually 2 digits, 1 and 0, or 11 or 12, they are using A to F as letters. You may see them either in uppercase, which is the most cases, but you may also see them in lowercase. For instance, when you print the address of an object in Java, you will see some hexadecimal number because they don't want to present it to you in binary. It will take a very long space and either hard to remember, but hexadecimals are more compact and easier to remember. In some cases, you may actually see also octal number systems. Octal has digits from 0 to 7. Now, as I said, binary numbers are long and hard to remember. So you will never remember something like this, 10101010100. So hexadecimals are usually used to abbreviate those binary numbers. In this case, this is actually abbreviated with AAA in hexadecimal. And as I said, the hexadecimal system has 16 digits, where the letters from A to F represent 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 for E, and 15 for F. Octal numbers have 8 digits. And actually, if you convert binary to octal, every 3 digits, actually from the right-hand side, grouped from the right-hand side, is converted into one octal digit. So that's why I said here below, each octal digit corresponds to 3 bits. Similarly, for hexadecimal, every 4 digits bits are actually abbreviated with one hexadecimal character. Again, you start grouping from the right-hand side. Everything in these number systems is done from the right to the left. So the grouping is done here from right to left. Any questions? So let's learn a bit, a bunch of conversions. So first conversion from binary to decimal. So given that you have a binary number, chess digits BN to B0, the equivalent decimal value for that binary number is BN multiplied with 2 to the power N plus BN minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power N minus 1 and so on up to B0, the last digit, which has the index 0, multiply with 2 to the power 0. So basically, you take the binary number, you index it from right to left, starting with index 0, and then you increment with 1 for every position to the left. And then you have the basically power to which you would raise the base. So now you take that digit bn and you multiply with 2 to the power n. So for instance, 1, 0 in binary is 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 1 plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0, which is basically 1 multiplied with 2, which is 2. So basically the binary number, and usually this is the notation that is used, the number is within parentheses, and then the base appears as a subscript. And since I can't type subscript, I've written it this way. So it's equal with 1 multiply with 2 to the power 1 plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. It's really, if every digit is basically given an index and you start from the left hand the right hand side and you increment as you go to the right hand side, and then every digit here is multiplied with the base to the power of that index. So this is why we have that this is equal with 2 in decimal. So every single other number, if we have this number in binary, 1010 in binary, is going to be equal with 1 multiplied with. So again, start with the indices above. So this will have the index 0. This has 1, 2, and 3. So now it will be the first digit is 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 3. Plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 2. Plus 1 again multiplied with 2 to the power 1. Plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. And this is equal with 8 plus 2, which is equal with 10. So the binary number 1010 is equal with the decimal number 10. And similarly, every other binary number, you can take longer binary numbers and practice this way to translate them into the decimal number, corresponding decimal number. Next question is, how do you convert a decimal number to a binary number? So for instance, I give you 10, and how do I find the binary number that corresponds to that 10, but in base 2, okay? And there is an algorithm for translating into binary base. So basically the idea is that we want that sequence of binary digits, bits, bn, bn minus 1, bn minus 2 up to b0, such that the decimal number that we were given is equal with bn multiplied with 2 to the power n plus bn minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power n minus 1 and so on up to b0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. And the question is, how do we find this binary number? And the algorithm says that actually we start dividing by 2. So 123, for instance, divided by 2 gives us the quotient 61 and the remainder 1, because 123 is equal with 61 multiplied with 2, which is 122, plus the remainder 1. And we continue this algorithm. So basically now 61 is divided by 2 and we take the remainder 1 and the quotient 30. 30 divided by 2 is 15 with remainder 0. 15 divided by 2 is 7 with remainder 1. 7 divided by 2 is 3 with remainder 1. 3 divided by 2 is the quotient 1 with the remainder 1. 1 divided by 2 is the quotient 0 with the remainder 1. When we reach to 0 as the quotient, we stop and we read the remainders in reverse order as we obtain them. So basically, now we have 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1 as the binary number that corresponds to 123. So this is how is done this translation from binary to decimal. So for instance, in our case, we have 10. So we take 10, we divide it by 2, and we get the quotient 5 with the remainder 0. And then we take 5, we divide it by 2, and we get the quotient 2 with the remainder 1. And then we take 2, we divide it by 2, and we get the quotient 1 with the remainder 0. And we take 1, we divide it by 2, and we get the quotient 0 with the remainder 1. And now we can read in opposite order as we obtain them from the end to the beginning, the remainders. So 10 in decimal is equal with the binary representation 1010 in binary. And this is the algorithm. Basically, you want to convert in binary, you start dividing with 2. And at every step, you continue with the quotient for the next step. And this is basically gives you this algorithm. And you collect the remainders in opposite order as you obtain them. And that's basically the binary representation for that number. Okay. In fact, this algorithm also works for any other base. So if I want to convert 10 from decimal to octal, what is the octal number that represents the decimal 10? I will do exactly the same. I will divide 10 by 8. It gives me the quotient 1 and the remainder 8. Actually, yeah, remainder 2, sorry. Then we take 2, we divide by 8. It gives us 0 as the quotient with the remainder 2. We take 1. Okay, so now we got to the to the quotient 0. So 10 is equal with the octal number 1, 2 in octal. Okay, which is true because the same idea of how to convert back from octal to decimal is true here. Basically, we index every one of those digits, starting with 0 for the last digit, and then we increment with 1 to the left-hand side. So this will be equal with 1 multiplied with 8 to the power 1 plus 2 multiplied with 8 to the power 0, which is in fact 8 plus 2, which is equal with 10. So basically the same algorithm to translate from decimal to any base works as it would basically work for 2. Okay. So that's basically it, decimal to binary, and before we saw binary to decimal. Any questions before we continue to hexadecimals? If not, let's continue to hexadecimals. Hexadecimals are actually a multiple of 2. So 16 is 2 to the power 4. Really meaning that there is a direct translation. Instead of going from hexadecimal to decimal and decimal to binary, we can directly convert hexadecimals to binary and vice versa, binary to hexadecimal. So hexadecimals, as I said, are digits representing numbers that are in base 16. So basically, hexadecimal 0 corresponds to 0 bits, 4 0 bits, 0, 0, 0, 0 in binary. one would correspond to 0001 in binary, and so on. Two corresponds to 0010. Three corresponds to 0011, and so on. So because every one of these hexadecimals corresponds to a decimal, by just multiplying that hexadecimal digit with 16 to the power zero. And basically we can translate the decimal into binary and we can precede it with zeros because zero translates into binary zero. But if you put any additional zeros in to the left of the number doesn't change. It's like in decimal, if I give you the number 123, it's still 123, no matter how many zeros I put it to the left of it. This is still 123, okay? It's the same for hexadecimal or even binary. So 00000010 is basically still the binary number 10, because all of these zeros multiplied with 2 to the powers basically are still zero. So basically any preceding zeros to the left of a number are zero. Okay. So that's why when I say that zero in hexadecimal or in base 16 is equal with 0000 in binary. Okay, because it's equal with zero in binary, but I can precede it with three zeros. So I can always have a three-bit representation for every hexadecimal number. So when we convert the hexadecimal to binary, we get a direct translation, a mapping. Here is the hexadecimal, and this is the four-bit binary number. If I want to translate a binary number to hexadecimal, so basically the opposite, I'm giving a binary number and I want the hexadecimal representation of it. First thing I group the digits, the bits, from the right-hand side four at a time. So every four binary digits from the right-hand side are grouped into groups of four. And then those four are using the same translation that we have. 1101 is D. So basically that corresponds to a D. 1000, it's an 8. And we can precede, like I said, any binary number with additional zeros to the left. So 11 is preceded by 00. So 0011 is mapped into 3. So this binary number is 38D in hexadecimal. The same idea applies to octal. So if I take the same number, 1100, 1101, and I want to transform it from binary to octal, what is this in base 8? I basically group three at a time from the right hand side. So is going to be 101, then 001, then 110, and just the 1, which I can put two zeros in front of you. It doesn't change the number. So when I translate it to octal, 1 is 1 in octal, then 110 is 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0, plus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 1, plus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 2. So it's 4 plus 2, it's 6. Then 001 is 1, and 101 is 4 plus 1, which is 5. So this binary number that we saw before is 1615 in octal. Okay. Any questions? Okay. So that's the translation from hexadecimal to binary and vice versa. Now, hexadecimals to decimal. The same algorithm that we talked about binary to decimal works here too, only that the base, the radix, is 16. So first of all, this hexadecimal number system has 16 digits, 0 to 9, and then A to F, corresponding to 10 to 15 for those letters. Given a hexadecimal number HN to H0, we translate it into decimal by taking every hexadecimal digit, like HN, multiply with 16 to the power N, the position of that digit, plus HN minus 1, multiply with 16 to the power N minus 1, and so on up to H0, multiply with 16 to the power 0. So for instance, as an example, 7F in hexadecimal is 7 multiplied with 16 plus F corresponds to 15, plus 15, which is 127 in decimal. So there is a direct translation from hexadecimal to decimal, and you need to multiply with 16. Now, another way to translate from hexadecimal to decimal, which you can actually find easier, is to translate from hexadecimal to binary and then the binary into decimal. Instead of doing multiplications of 16 with 16, you do multiplications with powers of 2. Not a big difference, but still some of you may prefer that. Another example here is FFFF in hexadecimal translated into decimal would be 15, which corresponds to F, multiplied with 16 to the power 3, plus 15 multiplied with 16 to the power 2, plus 15 multiplied with 16 to the power 1, plus 15, which is 65,535 in decimal. You will see that you start learning all of this by thinking of powers of 2. So the first thing that you should basically remember are the different powers of 2. 2 to the power 0 is 1, 2 to the power 1 is 2. Let's start with that first. And then we have 2 to the power 2 is 4. You take always the previous one and multiply it with 2, because that's basically what the power is. 2 to the power 3 is 2 to the power 2 multiplied with 2, so it's 8. So then 2 to the power 4 is 16. I was telling you earlier that there are computers that work in base 16. And then there are not in base 16, but in groups of memory of size 16 bits, because these are all powers of 2. 2 to the power 5 is 32. 2 to the power 6 is 64. 2 to the power 7 is 128. 2 to the power 8 is 256. 2 to the power 9 is 512. 2 to the power 10 is 1024. Okay. You see that 2 to the power 10 is about 1024. It's about 1K, 1000. Okay. Not exactly 1000, but close enough to 1000. That's why you can basically see that, oh, so 2 to the power 10 is 1000 or 1 kilobyte, then 2 to the power 20 is basically 2 to the power 10 multiplied with 2 to the power 10. So it's about, it's basically about 1 megabyte. It's not quite 1 megabyte. That's the entire idea, is really 1024 multiplied with 1024, but it's close enough to about 1 million, not quite, but about 1 million. Okay. That's about how you start learning the sizes, that number of bits that are representing different numbers. So 1 million, you would need about 20 bits to represent it. Okay. Because basically that's the size that you can represent with about 20 bits. Okay. Now, how do you translate to hexadecimal from decimal? About the same idea that you would do it for binary. So instead of dividing with 2, you divide with 16. Usually you don't need to do this by hand because division with 16 is not easy. But anyway, 123 divided by 16 gives us the quotient 7 and the remainder 11. 7 divided by 16 gives us the quotient 0 with the remainder 7. Therefore, 123 in hexadecimal is 7 B, because 11 is B. Okay. So that's basically how you convert directly from decimal to any other base. You start dividing with the radix or the base, and then you collect the remainders in the reverse order as you obtain them. So the last one will be the first digit. Similarly for base 8, you divide by 8. Now you will see that maybe it's an easier way to implement all of these conversions from any base to any base by converting first to binary and then that binary converted to base 10, to decimal. I told you also already about octal to binary. So octal basically corresponds, one digit in octal corresponds to 3 bits in binary. So when you convert from octal to binary, you just transform 0 into 3 zeros, 1 into 001, 2 into 010, 3 into 011, and so on. And if you translate from binary to octal, you group 3 bits from the right-hand side to the left-hand side. So 101 is 4 plus 1, which is 5. 001 is 1. 110 is 4 plus 2, which is 6. And 1 preceded by any number of preceding zeros, which is 001, is 1. Okay. You can always use the Windows calculator to actually do these base translations. So you have the scientific calculator here, actually the programmer calculator, and you can basically transform from base to base. So you have 123 in decimal, it's 7B in hexadecimal, or 173 in octal, or 0111. 1011 in binary. Okay. You see that even the translation that we have in the Windows calculator has that extra zero in front, just because it's these binary numbers are stored internally in bytes, these sequences of 8 bits at the time. Okay, now let's talk about memory. So we are now clear about binary to decimal and decimal back to binary. The memory, the main memory, is actually also sliced into different parts. There is a part called the stack. The stack is used for executing methods. Executing a program basically means that you start with the main method. The main method calls another method that's put on top of the activation record or the frame for the main method. So now you have a different referencing environment or set of variables. That method may call a different method. So you put them like a stack. You put them on top of each other. When you finish with one, you return to the previous one. So it's basically a data structure that grows. You can put on top and you can pick only from the top of that data structure. Another segment into the main memory is called a heap. This is used for allocating objects randomly. One method creates a new string. It returns it as the return value to the previous parent memory method. You still want it active, even if the stack was deleted, or the previous activation record was deleted. So basically the heap is, it's like basically a piece of paper and you can write anywhere on the piece of paper. Okay, it's used for dynamic data that can be added at any moment in any place. And usually this is done with an operator called new in Java. You create a new string or you create a new person or you create a new stack, anything, you put it on the heap. Again, it's persistent as long as these objects are still referenced in Java. So Java does what is called garbage collection, automatic garbage collection. It means that if you have a variable in your program that has the address of that object in the heap, that object is maintained in the heap. But the moment that there is no variable to access that object anymore, Java goes and deletes that object from the heap. Okay. So it's really like a notebook which somebody from time to time, which is in our case Java, cleans it up. If there are things that I don't even remember that I left them in, they will be removed. The next segment of memory is called the global segment or the static segment. This is the place where your program is stored. When your program starts running, the CPU took that program from the disk and put it into the main memory in the global segment. There are other things that are stored in the global segment, like static variables. These are variables that are associated with the class itself. And because you can access them from any object or from any point in the program, they are stored in the global segment. So static data is stored in the global data, in the global segment. So is the program that you are executing. Now, how are objects actually stored? They are stored in slices of bits, okay, of these binary numbers. And Java remembers the address where these objects are put in memory. How? Because the entire memory is sliced into slices. Initially, these slices were of 8 bits, but basically we realized that we have bigger and bigger things to store. Like for instance, now a character takes 32 bits. So basically you need to store a slice of 4 bytes to store a single character. Similarly, you may have bigger things to store. Like for instance, this computer that I'm using, it's a 64-bit machine, meaning that every location is of 64 bits and we can address it. We have an address also in binary to address that specific location. These addresses are called pointers. They are basically a specific type of data which is used just to access another data. Okay. So pointers are actually addresses in the main memory stored into different locations. So hardware uses 0 ones to store anything, but we have a long sequence of 0 and 1s, especially when we had any kind of memory devices, rotating memory devices or flash drives. You have basically a long array or sequence of 0 and 1s. This sequence of 0 and 1s are basically sliced into groups of 8, and those bits are called a byte. And we can use them to store any kind of data. We can use numbers to store, like for instance, decimal translating into binary and store. We can also use store characters as long as we have a translation scheme from binary to the character and from the character back to binary. Initially, there were very simple translation schemes. ASCII was such a translation scheme. It basically could only represent 128 or 27 different characters. And each character had a predefined binary number or number that is stored. Now, even instead of thinking in binary, we think in decimal. So for instance, the character A is the decimal number 65, and 65 is translated in binary. So I don't need to remember what is 65 in binary. I can't. It's basically, I cannot remember binary things, but I can remember the decimal representation of that binary number that represents the character. So ASCII was quite limited. It could store special characters. It could store some all kinds of signs, space, exclamation sign, quote, double quote, hash sign, and so on. And you can see here all the different representations, basically what is that in decimal 32, like for space, 32 decimal is 20 in hexadecimal or 040 in octal. But internally, actually, all of this is represented in binary, only that I want to show you that space is the 32 decimal or uppercase A is 65 in decimal. Lowercase a is 97 in decimal, and so on. You don't need to remember this. These are just as an example So it started with a translation scheme of 127 characters, you see, or 128 characters, including zero or null. But that's not enough for representing characters in every single language on this planet. Basically, we have characters in Chinese, Arabic, Hebrew, Russian, and so on. Even in Romanian, which is my birth language, basically we have characters that are not represented in this set, okay? So basically there are better translation schemes today. One that is standard and used by all programming languages is called Unicode. It has 65,000 different characters. It has representations in this numeric format in binary of Chinese characters, every single Chinese character, every single Arabic character, every single Hebrew character, and so on. Okay. So these are translation schemes which are used by every computer. And today, this Unicode is the translation scheme that is used for computers. Any questions? Okay. Now, let's talk about programming languages. So the original programming languages were basically switches. So ENIAC, for instance, which was one computer that was actually created by John von Neumann and the Navy Research Lab, basically was a big computer where the input was given either as basically just switches, zero and ones, representing every switch is on one or zero, or cards, like basically paper cards that would represent these zero and ones with holes or no holes. Okay. This is basically very close to machine language. Machine language are basically binary representations or instructions. They are directly like some instruction 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 is an instruction to add, let's say. So the central processing unit would take this memory binary number and would interpret it as this is add instruction, this is divide instruction, this is multiply instruction, and so on. So at the beginning, it was just this machine language, a sequence of bits that directly implemented an instruction that the computer understood, like this sequence of binary digits represents add or subtract. Or moving data from one place to another in memory, or any kind of comparison, binary comparison, or Boolean operation, and so on. Like, for instance, this is a GCD program written in x86 machine language. So my computer is an Intel computer that has an operating system that is Windows, but internally, this hexadecimal, you see, it's a sequence of hexadecimal numbers. E is a hexadecimal number, and 83EC04, and so on. This basically is the machine language implementation of the classical algorithm for greatest common divider. Okay. So that's basically what machine language was. What's a sequence of bits which can be translated into decimal or hexadecimal is basically numbers, nothing else, that which represent instructions. Of course, nobody could, some people could write machine language, but it was quite hectic because you basically had to represent in binary every single instruction. So assembly languages were invented. They were actually mnemonic abbreviations for the machine language. So basically, whatever sequence was for add 5589 was translated into the mnemonic add F3. So this is a string representation for that, a textual representation for that machine language. And there was a program called an assembler that converted this assembly textual language into the machine code. In fact, all that it had to do was that this string representation corresponds to the binary instruction. So it's just a mnemonic abbreviation for those machine level languages. It was good for the fact that now people didn't have to write programs in binary, they could write them into assembly. So an assembly would be interpreted by an assembler, and the assembler would provide from a text file a machine code file, which was pure binary in slices of 8 bits, which basically had the machine code. And here is the GCD program, that same program that you saw before in machine language, in assembly language. There is a question in the chat. Why three arguments? Input, two inputs, and an output. So basically that add that you saw before, let me click here, that add that you see before is read the register R1, a specific location in the cache, and the register R2, add them and store them in register R3. Okay, good. Okay, so this was good, but it was far easier to use English or this assembly language instead of machine language. But still, it was not friendly. It was very low level operations, and programming was still time consuming. Moreover, different architectures have different sets of assembly instructions. In fact, different machine language underneath. So basically, there is the x86 assembly language, and there is MIPS, and there is ARM computer assembly or machine language, and so on. So it was still very low level. And it was still for a specific architecture, or even worse, for a specific computer. So a new type of languages were invented called higher level programming languages. Basically, now these are statements which would take one line in the new programming language like C or Java, but they would be translated into multiple assembly instructions. Okay. Moreover, the translation is done machine specific. So for Windows or for x86, it would translate this high level language into binary machine language for x86 architecture, for this specific type of processor that understands x86 machine language. For a different architecture like ARM computer would translate it in that machine language. So the idea was that now we have higher level programming languages, easier to remember instructions, more friendly. We, with one simple instruction, we do multiple operations at a low level. We can define the entire method and use the signature of that method to invoke it. And it would be, as I said, platform independent, because the compiler or the interpreter would translate it into the machine language underneath the high-level language. And the first high-level programming language was Fortran. Lisp was also a functional programming language. COBOL, you may have heard of some of these languages, because in fact, they are still used today. And this is the problem kind of software engineering, that once very complex and big programs were developed, it's very hard and time and price consuming to actually translate them into a different, more modern programming language. So you may actually even see from time to time ads for, we are looking for COBOL programmers because we have this NASA program or a bank program that is implemented in COBOL, and nobody wants to translate that entire 500,000 lines program into Java or C or JavaScript. Okay. So these are all programming languages. They are sorted kind of historically. So Fortran, Lisp were the first two programming languages. Then C, before C, there was a different programming language called B. Then there was the first object-oriented programming language. It was Smalltalk. It's not even in this list, but C++ was the one that basically was an object-oriented programming language, initially translated into C, then C to machine language. Nowadays, C++ is directly implemented, is translating, it's a different programming language, is directly compiled into binary code. Java followed the idea of C++, only with simpler implementation. You didn't have pointers, so you didn't have direct access to the memory. Simpler kind of to program, you don't need to actually do pointer arithmetic. Also, it has automatic garbage collection, so you don't need to actually do your own garbage collection, which usually leads to memory leaks. Things are created and somebody forgets to actually remove them when nobody uses them anymore. C# was basically a Java-like language that Microsoft developed. Python, Lua, and so on are newer programming languages, JavaScript too. Yes, functional programming languages are higher level. Basically, you are not programming into, in fact, they are, in some opinion, in my opinion too, higher than imperative programming languages, because you define functions and these are kind of like a higher level. You can pass functions to other functions as parameters. All of this is not in machine language. You are implementing at the level of a higher programming language, which is compiled internally into binary code. No. So SML is a higher programming language. And so is Lisp, in this list, that is a functional programming language. Excellent. Okay, so now we can go. So how is a higher level programming language run on a computer? And usually it's run in two different ways. There is a compiler, it's a software program whose input is the higher level programming language and output is the assembly code. So basically it takes the higher level programming language and it compiles it into assembly or machine language. It's typically integrated with an assembler. So here is the standard way that the compiler works for C. The source code is compiled into a machine language file, which is basically doesn't include the libraries that are imported. A linker will basically link now those libraries into one executable file or an assembly file that contains the entire program. Okay, this is a C compiler, an older level C compiler. Let me see, there are some questions in the chat. Isn't C considered a low level? No, it's considered a high level programming language. It's an older programming language, but still you have for loops. These are not something that a processor understands. A for loop is actually a sequence of statements followed by a go-to statement, conditional go-to statement, which if the condition is true, it goes back to the position of the first statement in that loop. So C is a higher level programming language, which is a little bit older, okay? But it's not, it's older means that it's not actually obsolete. It's the operating system, no matter what operating system you are currently running, is implemented in C. The Linux kernel is implemented in C. The Android kernel internally is implemented in C. You basically have more programming on top of it, but the kernel itself, the one that is operating the file system, the user credentials, is all C because it's very fast. Once you program at that level, you develop programs that which are very fast. In fact, if you know assembly, you would program in assembly because that would be extremely fast, but it will take a lot of programming to write a program directly in assembly. There are antiviruses which are written in assembly because that's a place where you want your program to be extremely fast. Okay, good. So let's return back. So now let's talk about the operating system. So the operating system is another program which sits on the top of the computer architecture and simplifies the management of different components. So it defines a file system for you. It basically defines input output. It defines a user credential system that you can log in into the operating system and you have access to a certain subset of the operating system, file system. And there are different operating systems, Windows, Mac OS X, Android, Linux, and many others, many, many others. There are Unix-based operating systems, which basically are different than Linux. They were prior to Linux. Linux basically was the open source version of Unix. So the user interacts with application programs, which are implemented in some programming language, and they are executed on some operating system, which runs on top of the hardware. The user basically inputs data, and this data is usually, these inputs are captured by the operating system, and the operating system sends them to the application program that the user interacts with. And this is how an event system usually works like. Basically, when I click PowerPoint, my PowerPoint application, this click event is captured by the operating system, and because it detects that I clicked on a window or on a position that is occupied by this program, it sends that event to that program, which is PowerPoint in this case. Java, and so compilation is one way to execute programs. There is another way called interpretation. Instead of compiling the entire source code into an entire machine language and getting an executable file at once, you can take statement by statement. One statement is interpreted, and you basically run it on the machine. And that's called an interpreter. Java is somewhat different than older programming languages. It started with a principle. Sun, the company that created Java, the idea of Sun was write it once, run it anywhere. And it was kind of like a revolutionary idea, because prior to that, even C programs, you would write a C program that was for Linux or Unix, but the API was completely different for Windows. So you would have to write, if you wanted the same program to be run on different operating systems, you would have to write it multiple times, one for this operating system, one for this other one, and so on. Java started with this principle, write it once, run it anywhere. And what does that mean? It means that it's platform independence, that you write Java code. This Java code is actually compiled into bytecode, Java binary code. And even this binary code now can run on every one of these machines, because on top of the architecture and operating systems sits another middle layer called the Java virtual machine. It's a virtual computer in some sense. You basically have a virtual machine, this Java virtual machine, which can read Java bytecode and execute it. Execute it in the sense that it's an interpreter that takes every bytecode instruction and runs it into that specific machine language. So it does translation of one statement at a time into the machine language for that specific computer. Okay. So the bytecode is executed in this Java virtual machine. And then the only thing that the company Sun had to develop is a different virtual machine that sits on different operating systems. So, and that's why when you download JDK, it asks you, for what operating system are you downloading? Because this JVM is different. It's basically, this is what translates that standardized code, which is the Java bytecode, into the machine language corresponding to your computer. Okay. So that's why Java was successful for now almost 30 years. Basically, Java programs run on any machine. And that's why companies are suing themselves, like Oracle sues Google, because this was a revolutionary idea when Java was created, as one programming language that runs on anything. Okay. there were many different Java versions in